فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
If we look at the apparent essence of this hadith, and we look at the hadith that was taken, which is لا تقدموا رمضان بصوم يوم ولا يومين إلا رجل كان يصوم يوما فليصوم. If we look at the original essence of this hadith and we ponder on it, what will become clear to us is what? That the prohibition is restricted only to a day or two. A day or two. Most 2 days. That is restricted to 2 days. Okay? And then if it's 3 days or more, then it's permissible. That's what we can see from the hadith. فَيَجُوزُ ذَلِكَ إِذَا كَانَ بِثَلَاثَةِ أَيَّامٍ فَأَكْثَرٍ. And that is the opinion of the majority of the scholars. وهو الذي عليه جمهور أهل العلم. The majority of the scholars are of that opinion. Based on what hadith? Based on this particular hadith that we're taking. Like in the Shafi'iyya, they took another opinion. The Shafi'iyya, they took a what? وَذَهَبَ كَثِيرٌ مِنَ الشَّافِعِيَّةِ. A lot of the Shafi'iyya, they took إِلَىٰ أَنَّ الْمَنْعَ. That the prohibition, it starts from half of Sha'ban. And Sha'ban is half. So basically when it's what? The 16th of Sha'ban onwards. من اليوم السادس عشر منه. From 16 and onwards. They believe that the prohibition starts from there. Where did they get that from? They got it from a hadith. يرويه العلاء ابن عبد الرحمن ابن يعقوب الجهني المدني. Who narrated from his father. He narrated from his father عبد الرحمن. Who then narrated from Abu Huraira رضي الله تعالى عنه مرفوعا. That the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, إذا انتصف الشعبان, if Sha'ban is half, فلا تصوموا, do not fast. If Sha'ban is half of it, then do not fast. This hadith is narrated by who? This is narrated by Ashab al-Sunan. Ashab al-Sunan, they narrated this hadith. And Imam al-Tirmidhi authenticated it. Ibn Hibban, he also authenticated it. Abu Awana, he authenticated it. Ibn Hazm, he authenticated it. Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, he authenticated it. Are you with me? Some may ask, where did you get the authentication of Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah? Because you're not going to find it in his Majmu' al-Fatawa, nor are you going to find it in his Sharh of Umda. So where would you get it? Ibn Muflih, he brings it in his Kitab al-Furu'. That Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, he authenticated it. Also, Ibn al-Qayyim authenticated it. And it's Tahdhib al-Sunan. Shaykh al-Albani, rahimahullah, Nasiruddin al-Albani, rahimahullah, he authenticated it. Ibn Baz also authenticated it. Those are all the scholars that what? Authenticated it. But there are others who weakened it. إِلَّا أَنَّ ضَعَفَهُ بَعْضُ الْأَئِمَّةِ. Some of the scholars weakened it. And from the top of those, on the list of those who weakened it, from the top of those who weakened it is عبد الرحمن بن مهدي, أحمد بن حنبل, يحيى بن معين, البيهقي. They all weakened it. And they also said that this hadith actually opposes a narration which is more authentic than it. They said it goes لمخالفة ما هو أصح من الأحاديث. It opposes a hadith which are more authentic than it. Which specifically speak about the issue of fasting in Sha'ban. Which it opposes. And what hadith are they referring to? The hadith, they're referring to the hadith which is in Bukhari and Muslim. Bukhari and Muslim, that Aisha said, لم يكن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يصوم شهرا, that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was not one that used to fast a month, أكثر من شعبان, more than شعبان. That there was no month in the year which the Prophet would fast more than شعبان. فإنه كان يصوم شعبان كله. The Prophet used to fast all of شعبان. So look what they're saying is, in another wording it says, كان يصله برمضان. Some of the other narrations say that he used to connect it with Ramadan. So they said here, on this argument, are you there? They said that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to fast all of Sha'ban. So if the prohibition started from half of Sha'ban, based on the hadith you guys brought, which is, إِذَا انْتَصَفَ شَعْبَان, if Sha'ban or half of it becomes, فَلَا تَصُومُوا, do not fast. They said, then why would the Prophet carry on fasting? You see, so they said, your hadith is weak number one, and it also opposes our hadith. Now, the issue of the authentication of the hadith, that is a long explanation. If you guys want to see more into it, go to Ibn al-Qayyim's Tahdhib al-Sunan. You will find it, the third volume, page 223. And Sheikh Muhammad Nasir al-Din al-Albani, he gave it justice. Alayhi rahmatullahi, may Allah have mercy upon him. But what seems apparent, my brothers, and those who are listening, inshaAllah ta'ala, is وَالَّذِي يَظْهَرُ وَاللَّهُ تَعَالَىٰ أَعْلَىٰ وَأَعْلَمُ. What seems apparent, and Allah is high above, and He's most knowledgeable, is that there is no ta'aruf. There is no opposition, there's no mu'arada. The narrations are not really contradicting themselves, and they're not coming against one another. And as you're all aware of, if a hadith can be brought together, that takes precedence over resulting to saying that it contradicts one another, or to leave in one. Are you with me? Al-jam'u awla min al-ihmali. To bring the narrations together and to come bring them together takes precedence over forsaking one narration and leaving one. Are you with me? And this is what's known as هذا أولى من ترجيح. This is one of the correct ways of doing ترجيح and bringing the narrations together. And one of the scholars who brought this hadith together and had done it with justice is Imam Tirmidhi rahimahullah. Imam Tirmidhi. He did it alayhi rahmatullah. Was he not from one of the people I told you that authenticated it? Tirmidhi was one of those people who authenticated it. When he authenticated it, he explained the meaning of the hadith. He said, ma'ana hadha al-hadith. He said that the meaning of this hadith is, عِنْدَ بَعْضِ أَهْلِ الْعِلْمِ, according to some of the scholars, أَنْ يَكُونَ الرَّجُلُ مُفْطِرًا, is that when, if the man has broken his fast, or he's not fasting. Are you with me? He said that this hadith of Al-Ala ibn Abd al-Rahman, which is a hadith, إِذَا انْتَصَفَ شَعْبَانَ فَلَا تَصُومُ, if Sha'ban, half of it hits. He said, the meaning of this hadith, according to some of the scholars, is that a person was not fasting in the beginning. Okay? And then when Sha'ban, half of it comes, فَإِذَا بَقِيَ مِنْ شَعْبَانْ شَيْءٌ, half of Sha'ban kicks in, he starts to say what? أَخَذَ فِي الصَّوْمِ لِحَالِ رَمَضَانِ. He starts to fast and he starts to do it. Are you with me? So basically, in other words, if you were not fasting before the 15 days of Sha'ban, if you weren't fasting before that, then you should not start fasting after that. You with me? Ibn Qudama, rahimahullah, in his Kitab al-Mughni, the fourth volume, page 327, he said, يمكن, it is possible, حمل هذا الحديث على نفي استحباب الصيام في حق من لم يصوم قبل نصف الشهر. Exactly what I said. He said that this hadith can be carried and it can be said that it is negating that it's recommended for the one who wants to fast, who hasn't fasted the first half of Rosh Aban. Okay? And the hadith of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she's talking about what? The person who was fasting all of Sha'ban. Because the Prophet would start from the beginning and he would carry it all on. So based on that hadith, Ibn Qudama said, فَلَا تَعَارُضَ بَيْنَ الْخَبَرَيْنِ إِذًا. Then based on those two hadiths now, there is no contradictions. They're not coming against each other. And like, look what he gives a qa'idah after that. He says, وَهَذَا أَوْلَى مِنْ حَمْلِهِمَا عَلَى التَّعَارُضِ وَرَدِّ أَحَدِهِمَا بِصَاحِبِهِ. And that's the most befitting thing a person should do, which is try to bring the narrations together and try to take the meaning together instead of just leaving some of the narrations. So here what becomes clear, يترجح, what comes to us as a conclusion is مذهب الشافعية, the Shafi'i madhab في أن المنع من الصيام يبتدئ من نصف شعبان, that the view of the Shafi'iyya that says that it's prohibited from fasting when half of Sha'ban comes is a very strong opinion, and that their opinion is based upon what? Lakin, if the person was not fasting, the first half of it. So what about this hadith? How does this hadith come into place now? That we have right now in front of us, which is لا تقدم رمضان بصوم يوم ولا يومين إلا رجل كان يصوم صوما فليصوم. We will say يتأكد النهي. The negation and the prohibition now becomes even more stronger if it's a day or two before it. So this hadith is showing more emphasis. Are you with me? More emphasis and of the prohibition, of course, in fasting a day or two before Ramadan. Very good. If you guys want to see more of this issue, then go to Sunan Abi Dawood, Sunan al-Tirmidhi, Sahih ibn Hibban, Al-Muhallal ibn Hazm, Al-Majmu' by Imam al-Nawawi, Hafidh ibn Hajar al-Fath al-Bari, go to Sahih al-Jami' al-Saghir by Al-Bari, and look at Fatawa Samahat al-Shaykh ibn Baz, rahimahullahu ta'ala. The fourth benefit that we take from this hadith, the fourth benefit, which is, what is the ruling in fasting before Ramadan for a person who didn't have the norms? It wasn't his norms to fast before Ramadan. Sorry, the hadith has, this hadith has indicated and it has shown us that if the person used to fast on the norms, and that would be a question one can ask himself. What does it mean by the on the norms? It means that he used to fast Mondays and Thursdays. Or he used to either fast Mondays or Thursdays. Or he'd only fast on Mondays, for instance. Or he would fast a fast on Nabiullah Dawood, كان يصوم يوما ويفطر يوما. He'd fast one day and he would break it one day. So he'd do 4 day fasting. Or he would fast 3 days of every month. He would fast. صوم آخر ثلاثة أيام من كل شهر. But what happened? Are you with me? It hit a day or two before Ramadan. Then it's permissible for him because the Prophet specifically said, إلا رجل كان يصوم يوما. إلا رجل كان يصوم صوما فليصوم. Except the person who used to fast, then let him fast. If the person has قضاء. قضاء meaning what? It's not his norms to fast Mondays or Thursdays. Okay, it's not his norms. But he's got 2 days of fasting left of the previous Ramadan. If he fasted before Ramadan, 2 days before Ramadan, then no problem. لا بأس به. There's no harm in that. Because if fasting, sunnah fasting, is permitted based on the hadith, إِلَّا رَجُّلُ كَانَ يَصُومُ صَوْمًا فَلْيَصُومُ, then of course, it is from what? مِنْ بَابِ الْأَوْلَى. It's more befitting that a wajib قَضَاءُ مِنْ رَمَضَانِ or a nazar, for it to take more precedence. It's more befitting. So the prohibition here, my brothers, is if the person is trying to fast a day or two because of he wants to be on the safe side. عَلَى سَبِيلِ الْإِحْتِيَاضِ. He's trying to be on the safe side. He's like, you know what? I don't know, man. It could probably be Ramadan. We don't know. We could always get it wrong. And he says, I'm going to fast a day or two before it. This is what's prohibited. And this is the reason why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he prohibited it. Alayhi salatu wasalam. So basically, in summary, that point, the prohibition encompasses two forms if it comes in. The first form is to initiate a fasting before Ramadan, a day or two before it, a voluntary fasting. A person comes and says, I never used to fast anyways, but you know what? I'm going to start fasting from now onwards. And he starts it a day or two before Ramadan. Just wants to initiate it from this minute onwards. And he never had the norms for it, then he falls under this prohibition. The second one is, the person initiates a fasting before Ramadan a day or two with the intention of being on the safe side. With the intention of what? بِنِيَّةِ الْإِحْتِيَاضِ لِرَمَضَانِ. To be on the safe side. He falls under this. And this is the فِعْلُ الرَّافِضَ. This is what the Rafida do. They believe that it's recommended to fast a day or two before Ramadan, the Rafid and the Shia. The fifth benefit that we take from this hadith and that we're going to conclude with, inshallah ta'ala, is what's the wisdom in the prohibition? What is the hikmah? What's the wisdom? Why did the Sharia choose to prohibit it? Now, brothers and those who are listening, inshallah ta'ala, you would all know that the wisdom in matter, in a command or a prohibition, a wisdom in Allah commanding something or prohibiting something in the Sharia, when we look at it, it occurs in two ways to know that wisdom. Knowing that wisdom in the Sharia, whether it's through a command or through a prohibition. So why did Allah command us? What's the wisdom behind it? Or why did Allah prohibit us? It occurs in two ways. In order to know that wisdom. One is mansus. Mansus. Mansus means it's actually mentioned. The Shari'ah, Allah mentions the wisdom. Did Allah tell us the wisdom of why He legislated fasting for us? Yeah. He said, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ يَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. So لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. So fasting, this is the hikmah in making. Are you with me?
No.
So it's mansus. Some are not mansus. They are mustambata. مَا مَعْنَى مُسْتَنْبَطَة. Scholars, they try hard to find out and they try to bring it out. They say the wisdom behind this is this, 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 this. Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, the great scholar, the great Hafiz, in his Kitab Fathul Bari, he brings three opinions of the wisdom of the why Allah prohibited us to fast a day or two before Ramadan, the wisdom behind it. And he weakened the first two opinions after he mentions it, and he chooses the third opinion and gives precedence to it. So Hafiz ibn Hajar, he brings the three opinions. He says the first one is, وَالْحِكْمَةُ فِي التَّقَوِّبِ. The first wisdom is, لِفَرْطِ لِرَمَضَانِ. Is that the person, he is strong, and he's physically in shape for Ramadan's coming. So when Ramadan comes, ليدخل فيه بقوة والنشاط, he's going to enter Ramadan with strength, and inshallah ta'ala he's going to enter with it. He's going to enter with it with enthusiasm, inshallah ta'ala. Ibn Hajar, then straight after that, he said, وفيه نظر, there's a look to that. Are you with me? The second wisdom that it is that these are all proposed opinions by scholars is al-hikmatu fi khashyatu ikhtilati an-nafli bil-fard, that the voluntary would mix with the obligatory. Ibn Hajar straight after that, he said wa fihi nadhar, there's a look to that. There's not, it doesn't seem correct, because both of those two opinions, what can eradicate it is what? The person is allowed to do it if he's done it out of norms. Are you with me? If he does it out of norms, he can do it. Does that make sense? The third reads hikmah, and he strengthened this one, which is لِأَنَّ الْحُكْمَ عُلِّقَ بِالرُّؤْيَةِ, because there's a law passed pertaining to the sighting of the crescent and the moon. So if a person surpasses it with a day or two, then what this person has done is he has slandered and he's criticized the hukum of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. And this ruling would have no weight, to be honest. And then he said, وَهَذَا هُوَ الْمُعْتَمَدِ, and this is correct. Now this is right. So what we realize from that is, this is really, in summary, حِمَايَةُ حُدُودِ الشَّرِيعَةِ. It is to safeguard the boundaries of the Sharia. And we will stop there, inshallah ta'ala. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. And if anyone wants to go more into watching, reading these points that we spoke about, is he can go to Al-I'lam bifawaid umdat al-ahkam by Ibn Mulaqid. He can go to Fathul Bari, he will see more. If you go to the Tawdih al-ahkam by Abdullah ibn Bassam, you will find good over there, inshallah ta'ala. And I'll conclude there. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. أستغفرك وأتوب إليه.